Well, good evening, Mitzelberian. Let's stand up. We are more than conquerors through Christ. Let's join together and let's sing where our confidence and hope is. When my hope and strength is gone, you're the one that calls me on. You are the life, you are the light that's in my soul.
Fire that cannot be
are more than conquerors through Jesus Christ. Amen. Yeah. Hey, Susan, do you have a video up there for Sanctity of Life Sunday? Let's go ahead and launch. I see Kathy
Welcome
in the back.
Welcome to Sanctity here she of is. Life Weekend. We thank you so much for walking alongside Options Pregnancy Center as we have started our track to get opened over the last year. I'm here to give you an update on Options Pregnancy Center in Scotts Bluff. We do have Jana hired as our executive director, and we are very pleased to have her. We have our building at 1308 Avenue B in Scotts Bluff. We are looking forward to opening doors soon and start helping our community and the women in the community with unplanned pregnancies. We look forward to counseling women, soon-to-be dads, families, grandparents, and women who are struggling with decisions they made in the past with an unplanned pregnancy. We would like you to, if you feel led, give a free will donation to Options Pregnancy Center. We would also appreciate brand new baby items to put in our Baby Bucks store. Couples who choose to keep their baby will earn money to spend in the Baby Bucks store through classes that they do at the center. You can drop off any of these items in the foyer. I will have the blue playpen set up again, and you can put all donated items in there. I will have it set up for a couple of weeks. We also ask that if you have gently used items, baby items, to donate, to please call the center at 308-633-6566, and we can arrange how to get those items from you. We thank you so much for the sanctity of life, because we are all fearfully and wonderfully made. Thank you. Have a good weekend.
Yes, if you have any more questions, it looks like Kathy's here tonight. I don't know if she'll be here at the services tomorrow, but hey, you guys luck out and you get her here. If you're coming back tomorrow for anything, wear your purple, because we're going to celebrate Sanctity of Life here at Mitchell Brewery, and just value what God has made in newborn babies within the womb, and we are praying for that life to be preserved. We pray for the end of abortion in America. We're going to sing a new song here. Pastor John gave me his sermon series and what the sermons were going to be, and at the bottom he had this song on there. And although we're talking about Abraham, this song has to do with the people that Abraham was promised to have. Abraham was promised the land, he was promised the seed, and that's the people and the blessing. So this song talks about God's faithfulness and deliverance from Egypt, how God brought them out. And in the same way that God brought them out, he brings us out of our own Egypt and our own slavery. So I'm going to read to you from Psalm chapter 105, and you're welcome to follow along there, and then we'll sing the song together. I'm going to read the entire psalm because it's important for us to remember God's faithfulness to his people. So this is straight out of Psalm 105. Give thanks to the Lord and proclaim his greatness. Let the whole world know what he has done. Amen. Sing to him, yes, sing his praises. Tell everyone about his wonderful deeds. Are you doing that? Exalt in his holy name. Rejoice, you who worship the Lord. Search for the Lord and for his strength, and continually seek him. Remember the wonders he has performed, his miracles, and the rulings he has given. You children of his servant Abraham, you descendants of Jacob, his chosen ones, he is the Lord our God. His justice is seen throughout the land. He always stands by his covenant, the commitment he made to a thousand generations. This is the covenant he made with Abraham and the oath he swore to Isaac. He confirmed it to Jacob as a decree and to the people of Israel as a never-ending covenant. I will give you the land of Canaan as your special possession. He said this when they were only a few in number, a tiny group of strangers in Canaan. They wandered from nation to nation, from one kingdom to another, yet he did not let anyone oppress them, and he warned the kings on their behalf, "Do not touch my chosen people, and do not hurt my prophets."
He called for famine on the land of Canaan, cutting off its food supply. Then he sent someone to Egypt ahead of them, Joseph, who was sold as a slave. They bruised his feet with fetters and placed his neck in an iron collar until the time came to fulfill his dreams, and the Lord tested Joseph's character. Our sermon today is following God into testing. God tested Joseph. Then Pharaoh sent for him and set him free. The ruler of the nation opened his prison door. Joseph was put in charge of all the king's household, and he became ruler over all the king's possessions. He could instruct the king's aides as he pleased and teach the king's advisors. Then Israel arrived in Egypt. Jacob lived as a foreigner in the land of Ham. And the Lord multiplied the people of Israel until they became too mighty for their enemies. And he turned the Egyptians against the Israelites, and they plotted against the Lord's servants. But the Lord sent his servant Moses along with Aaron, whom he had chosen. They performed miraculous signs among the Egyptians and wonders in the land of Ham. The Lord blanketed Egypt in darkness, for they had defied his commands to let his people go. He turned their water into blood, poisoning all fish. The frogs overran the land and even invaded the king's bedrooms. When the Lord spoke, flies descended on the Egyptians and gnats swarmed across Egypt. He sent them hail instead of rain, and lightning flashed over the land. He ruined their grapevines and the fig trees and shattered all trees. He spoke and hordes of locusts came, young locusts beyond number. They ate up everything green in the land, destroying all the crops in their fields. Then he killed the oldest son in each Egyptian home, the pride and joy of each family. The Lord brought his people out of Egypt loaded with gold and silver, and not one among the tribes of Israel even stumbled. Egypt was glad when they were gone, for they feared them greatly. The Lord spread a cloud above them as a covering and gave them a great fire to light the darkness. They asked for meat, and he sent them quail. He satisfied their hunger with manna, bread from heaven. He split open a rock, and water gushed out to form a river through the dry wasteland. For he remembered his sacred promise to his servant Abraham. So he brought his people out of Egypt with joy, his chosen ones with rejoicing. He gave his people the lands of pagan nations, and they harvested crops that others had planted. All this happened so they would follow his decrees and obey his instructions. Praise the Lord. God is faithful to his people Israel. He is faithful to us. He wants to deliver us. I won't forget the wonder of how you brought deliverance, the exodus of my heart. You found me, you freed me, held back the waters from my release. Oh, Yahweh, you're the God who fights for me, Lord of day. There's a sign that you are with me. The fire by night is the guiding light to my feet. You found me, you freed me, held back the waters from my release. Oh, Yahweh, you're the God. You're the God who fights for me, Lord of
Jesus Christ, my living.
Scripture that God provides a way of deliverance. Man, I love that story. It's how God answered prayer. And each one of you has a story of how God's delivered, worked a miracle in your life. Remember that and give Him glory for it. Through every battle, through every heartbreak, through every circumstance, I believe that You are my fortress. Oh, You are my portion. Yeah, You are my hiding place, Jesus. I believe You are the way, the truth, and the life. I believe every promise, through every breath I take, I believe that You are provider. I believe it. That You are protector, and You are the one I love. Oh, I believe You are the way, Jesus, the truth. Faith, I'm delivered. It's a new horizon, and I'm set on You. And You made me here today with mercies that are new. All my fears and doubts, well, they can all come too, because they can't stay long when I'm here with You. It's a new horizon, and I'm set on You. And You made me here today, mercies that are new, yeah. All my fears and doubts, they can all come to, because they can't stay long when I believe You are the way and the truth. Through Scripture, and we look at Your faithfulness in our lives, and we remember, kind of character that our God has. That you are a deliverer by faith in Jesus Christ alone. We are delivered from the punishment that our sin brings on us. Thank you, God, for making a way. You are the way. You are the truth. And you are the life. Help us to trust you, God. Full reliance on you. Our confidence is in the one who will make a way. We pray this in your name, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Welcome, everybody. Welcome to those joining us online. Glad that you're all here. We're continuing a series called Leave Your Native Country. We're looking at the life of Abraham, or Abram, as he's known in the beginning of the story in Genesis chapter 12. We're going to continue in his story. If you want to turn there in your Bible, if you got a Bible with you or Bible app on your phone, Genesis chapter 12 is where we're going to be. And last week we looked at following God into the unknown. We're starting a new year here, and certainly the future is unknown to us. We have people that like to predict the future, give us an idea of what's going to happen, but most often those guesses are wrong in some way, and so we don't have a lot of certainty about the future. We do have a lot of prophecy in Scripture that indicates to us what the future holds. A lot of that prophecy, or most of the prophecy in the Bible, has not been fulfilled yet. And so we do have some information that we can glean from the Scriptures and we need to be aware of. So as we see the times approaching for the second coming of Jesus, we're aware. But we still don't have a lot of specifics about what's going to happen tomorrow, what's going to happen this year. And so we look at the story of Abram to glean some wisdom and to get an idea of how God works in the lives of people. And so Genesis chapter 12 is where we'll be. Let's would you join me as we begin? I just want to open us with prayer. God, we thank you so much for your presence with us. We thank you for a new year, the opportunity to follow you, to live for you. And Father, I pray that you would help us to see in the life of Abram wisdom. Help us to learn from his life and from how you interacted with him so that we can see how you're working in our lives. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So how are you doing today? How's 2021 going so far? How's it going? Are you in the middle of a storm, a test, a trial? It's been said that if you're not in one now, just wait a couple days, right? The weather will change. When storms or tests or trials hit, I'll be honest, I have a tendency to react. React a little bit. I try to stay calm. I try to be even keel. But there are things that can get a reaction out of me, all right? And I don't like to show it, so nobody may know. But there's something going on inside of me, and it's usually a reaction. Certainly my wife can tell, even if no one else can, right? She's lived with me long enough. But I don't know. There's people that don't seem to react to anything and just calm and even keel all the time. I'm not sure I trust them, to be honest with you. Like, I mean, come on, man. Life is real. And if you don't really get ruffled by anything, I don't know. There's a Navy law that says it this way. If you can keep your head when all about you, others are losing theirs, maybe you just don't understand the situation. I mean, really. Like, you know, ignorance is bliss. And you just aren't aware of what's going on. Maybe you don't react. But for me, the older I get, unfortunately, the more I understand in some ways about life and what's going on, I can see the implications of things. When something goes wrong, man, here we go. It's going to be stressful. It's going to be difficult. Maybe this is how the disciples felt when they were out on the lake with Jesus one day after serving, ministering to people all day in Mark chapter 4. Starting verse 35, the story is recounted to us. They get done with a day of ministering. Jesus said, let's get on the boat. Let's go across the lake to the other side. And so they get on the boat. They start going across the lake, and it's night. It's in the evening. And so all of a sudden, a storm hits. And Jesus is conveniently asleep in the back of the boat. His head's on a pillow. He's tired from the day of serving and ministering to people, and he's asleep. And the disciples get kind of worked up because the storm is real. These guys are not landlubbers, right? They're fishermen. They know when to be scared in a boat. The Bible says that the waves are coming over the bedge of the boat, and it's filling up with water. And they know something's going to happen. And so they wake Jesus up. Hey, man, teacher, don't you care that we're going to drown? Maybe you feel like that. Maybe you're in a storm, or you've been walking through a storm or a trial or a difficulty, and you're wondering if God is aware of it. Does he know? You feel like things might not work out. We might not make it. The Bible teaches us that God will test us in order to build our faith. But maybe you feel like Job. You know the story of Job? Job went through a tremendous test. And it was extremely painful and difficult. In Job chapter 7, starting verse 17, Job is talking to God, and he says it this way. What are people that you should make so much of us, that you should think of us so often? For you examine us every morning and test us every moment. Why won't you leave me alone, at least long enough for me to swallow? I don't know, maybe you're like, okay, God, enough. Enough. Like, the test is great, but can we go into a season of peace, or can we get through this? I think it's normal. I think it's human to feel that way. Tests are hard. Trials are hard. Storms are tough. God tells us that testing is a way for us to prove who we really are. 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 6 and 7 says, so be truly glad. There's wonderful joy ahead, even though you must endure many trials for a little while. These trials will show you that your faith is genuine. It is being tested as fire tests and purifies gold, though your faith is far more precious than mere gold. So when your faith remains strong through many trials, it will bring you much praise and glory and honor on the day when Jesus Christ is revealed to the whole world. So did you catch that? Your faith is going to be tested to prove that it's real. He says it's tested like gold is refined in the fire. But he said, even though your faith is much more precious than gold. Sometimes we need to remember that. We think that gold is more important, and having it is more important than our faith making it through a test. No, your faith is more precious. It's more valuable. It's more important for your life. James tells us that we can look forward to testing and trials because God has a purpose in them. James 1 verses 2 through 4 says, dear brothers and sisters, when troubles of any kind come your way, consider it an opportunity for great joy. For you know that when your faith is tested, your endurance has a chance to grow. So let it grow. For when your endurance is fully developed, you will be perfect and complete, needing nothing. There's a purpose. We can grow to the place where we understand that storms and trials and tests are for our good. But that's not easy. It's not easy. The truth is that when we step out to follow Jesus into the unknown, we will encounter difficulties. When you follow Jesus into the unknown, a crisis will come. Genesis 12, reading the story of Abram, continue in verse 12. Follow along as I read this verse. At that time, a severe famine struck the land of Canaan, forcing Abraham to go down to Egypt, where he lived as a foreigner. Remember last week we looked at how Abram was told by God to leave his native country and to go to a land that God would show him. So he left. Ur of the Chaldees is where he was from, a very fertile, rich area. Crops grew, probably where the Garden of Eden was. Beautiful area. He left that. Headed to Haran, which was to the north and a little bit to the west. And then God appeared to him, said, go to a land I'll show you. And Abram left, and he headed south to Canaan. When he got there, God appeared to him. and said, this is the place. I'm going to give this land to you and your inheritance. And so he built some altars and he worshiped God. Remember? And at that time, when he just got there, and God's reaffirmed his promise, he's going, all right, oh boy, here we go. I'm in the land God's given me, and things are going to go great, and we're going to build up. My family's going to grow, and God said I'm going to have a bunch of children. And so I'm excited to see these promises come true. And a famine strikes, and he's forced out. Didn't know what to do. Abram doesn't know God very well, right? He hasn't walked with God very long. Remember, his dad, Terah, was polytheistic. He worshipped probably the sun, moon, and stars, and probably had idols that he worshipped of created things. He didn't know the one true creator God. And so Abram is learning who God is. God's teaching him. And so a storm hits, a famine hits. Abram had a big family he was responsible for. He didn't have any kids yet, but he had a lot of servants. He had a lot of animals. He had a lot of people that he was responsible to feed. Famines will come into your life often when you've just made a decision to step out in faith. That's usually when it happens, just like it happened to Abram. Abram faces a crisis like we all do. We face crises anyway, but when we choose to step out in faith, that's when a crisis oftentimes hits. The solution to navigating a life of faith is to keep your focus on Jesus and to remember the purpose of the storm. One of the early explorers of South Africa's ocean waters was Bartholomew Diaz. He went around the Cape on a stormy sea. His ship was threatened to go to pieces in the storm, and so he called the place the Cape of Storms. But Vasco da Gama came along later. He changed the name to the Cape of Good Hope, because when he rounded the Cape, he saw the jewels and treasures that India held that he was going to have access to. We can look at this life as a life of storms. We can. We can see it that way, and we can see the crises and the famines and the things that happen, just constant tests and pressures, and go, this life is nothing but storms. But if we keep our eyes on eternity and on the call of God on our lives and the fact that there's a purpose in these storms, then we can call this life a life of good hope. The truth is that crises and storms in life are scary, and they cause us great alarm. Don't let anyone get on you for reacting to a storm. It means you're human. I think it's okay to be human in this regard. The Bible characters reacted to the storms that they faced. They didn't just act like everything was calm, cool, and collected all the time. They reacted at times. And because you're human, you're probably going to react at times to a storm, a crisis, a famine. However, reacting, your first reaction cannot be where you stay. You have a responsibility. You must make an adjustment, because God has called us to live by faith and to trust in him. Crises are there for a reason. Famines do come for a purpose, and they serve a purpose in our walk of faith. Abram does panic when a storm hits, when a famine hits in his life. He panics a little in this crisis, but he's still listed in Hebrews 11, right? Hebrews chapter 11 is the faith chapter in the Bible. If you haven't read Hebrews 11, you need to. Read it tonight. It's powerful. But Abram's listed in there, or Abraham, as one who lived by faith. And so his panic here, the story we're reading today, does not define his whole life. But we can learn from it, because we face the same kinds of things. I genuinely believe it's okay if you freak out a little bit when a storm hits, when a crisis hits. But what do you do next? How do you determine what you're going to do? How do you make a decision as to what your reaction is going to be? It's often said that your response is your responsibility. You probably heard that. Your response is your responsibility. In a crisis, I think your actions are your responsibility. What do you do when you face a storm, a crisis, or a famine? Your first reaction to a crisis, a storm, a famine, is going to be to do what Abram does. You will want to use human wisdom to solve it. That's what you're going to want to do. It's what we learn to do. It's what we train ourselves to do. Let's see what Abram does when he hits a crisis, when he hits a famine and a storm. We already know he's headed to Egypt. Genesis 12, continuing verse 11, says this, as he was approaching the border of Egypt, Abram said to his wife Sarai, "Look, you're a very beautiful woman. When the Egyptians see you, they will say, 'This is his wife. Let's kill him. Then we can have her.' So please tell them, 'You're my sister.' Then they will spare my life and treat me well because of their interest in you." Abram sees a problem. He goes, "We're going down to Egypt. The times he lived in, this was a legitimate concern. He had a beautiful wife. He was going into a land that he wasn't from. He was going to be an outsider and a foreigner. He didn't have the protection that would be afforded people that were from that area. He didn't have any connections. He's concerned. Remember what happened with David and Bathsheba, right? Uriah the Hittite. David fell in love with Bathsheba, Uriah's wife. He had him killed so he could have her. This was not out of the norm. This was a normal thought process for Abram to have, to be concerned about. This famine forces him to go down to Egypt. You know, in Egypt, the Nile River provided water for the region, irrigation, and they had a developed irrigation system to water that plain and that river valley. And so it was fertile, and there was produce there. Canaan relied just on rain. That was all there was. And so it was a fertile land as well. But if the rain stopped, then there were no crops. There was no grass for the livestock. And so he was in a legitimate situation, a legitimate problem. The Bible oftentimes explains a famine as being a season of judgment by God. That's how the Bible oftentimes explains why a famine happens. But in this case, we don't see that. We don't see that explanation. And so here's Abram, legitimate problem. I got a lot of mouths to feed. I got no food. Let's go down to Egypt where it's fertile. When I get there, I got a problem though. My life is going to be threatened because of my wife. And so he comes up with a human solution, uses his reason, his craftiness, his ingenuity, right, to figure out how to solve it. The problem is lying to Pharaoh about his wife was a problem. It's a huge issue because God had promised Abram that he was going to make him into a nation, that Sarai was going to be the mother of a whole nation of people. And he put her in jeopardy because of what he did. See, essentially, Abram was prostituting her out to Pharaoh and to the men of the land, saying, "You're my sister." They're going to pull her in, and that's what's going to happen. That's really what he's saying. And so there's a problem because of what God had promised him with his own reason and his own ability to figure out what to do with the situation. Sometimes we might know what the wisdom of God is for a situation. We might know, or we at least know where to find it. We know that the Bible probably speaks to something that we're about to do. There's probably some wisdom in there for a decision we're trying to make. Sometimes, though we know where to go to find it, we don't really want it. Because we want the ability to do what we want to do. Kind of like the school teacher who lost her life savings in a business scheme that had been elaborately explained to her by a swindler. When her investment disappeared and her dream shattered, she went to the Better Business Bureau. They said, "Why on earth didn't you come to us first before you made this investment? Didn't you know about us? Didn't you know we were here?" She said, "Yeah, I knew you were here. I've always known about you, but I didn't want to come because I was afraid you'd tell me not to do it." The folly of human nature is that even though we know where the answers lie, oftentimes we want to make our own decision. We want to do what we want to do. Human nature or human reason is powerful. It's a powerful pull. It comes from us. It comes from ourselves, our own experience, our life that we've discovered, things we've figured out. And it's a strong pull to go that direction, to utilize it to make decisions about the issues we face in life. At times, we think it's even unreasonable to do anything else. We can say to ourselves, listen, man, how am I supposed to do anything else but follow my human nature? It's the most powerful force in me. Recently, I read a book on servant leadership, and it was talking about this issue. It was talking about how we should serve the people we're responsible for, right? Servant leadership. It's actually in the Bible, and a lot of the concepts and the things that were presented in the book came from Scripture. And so it was arguing that we should love those that we have authority over. We should treat them with love. And he went into the definition of love in the human in the English language has to do with feelings. Every definition we have of love has to do with feelings. Yet the Bible has a word called agape, which is a Greek word that has a definition of love which is not feeling-oriented, but it's action-oriented. It's a verb. And so the idea is that you can love your enemy, not meaning that you have good feelings about them, but you can act with love towards them. You can do the right thing. You can treat them with respect. You can treat them with kindness. You can speak to them the correct way, right? You can do those things even if you have no good feelings. You know the person is trying to get rid of you, trying to destroy you. You can still act with love because it's not a feeling. It's a verb. It's an action. And so challenging that, this was a presentation. And then it goes into the idea that many people say, well, human nature does not do that. How can I be expected to treat someone and to love them, right, when they're difficult to work with, they're hard to be around? This isn't go with human nature. My human nature goes against that. And he had an interesting rebuttal to that I never heard before. It's a little bit, I think you guys can handle it, Saturday night service. He said this, human nature is to urinate down your leg. All right, that's human nature. If we want to just get down to it, if your bladder's full, babies, right, bladder gets full, what do? They just go. That's why we put diapers on them. But pretty quickly, we expect babies to hold it. Now, it can be a tough training deal, especially boys. Like, it take a little while, but they get it. I don't know any adults that continue to do that, right? Everyone learns to hold that. In fact, we can even teach our dogs to do that. So here's the thing. The book just said, listen, the point was, human nature is not an excuse not to do what's right. Even for pagans, even for people that don't know God. So how much more should it not be an excuse for us? That we would say, listen, what is it that I'm supposed to do? What is it that God is telling me to do? What's the action I'm supposed to take in the middle of this crisis and storm? And so I just want to challenge us. We have the ability through faith, by a walk with God that's growing and maturing, we have the ability to handle the storms of life, the famines that we face, and to do it the right way. To do it not out of our human nature, but out of our faith. We can be tempted, I'm tempted at times to say, it's just who I am, right? I know I got a temper, it's just who I am. It's a family trait, right? It's just part of my, you know, it's part of my heritage. Yeah, I know it probably isn't the best, but it's just who I am. Listen, I just want to encourage us. That really isn't a good excuse. It's not for me and it's not for any of us. We must learn and move towards maturity in Christ and grow in our faith so that we can handle those things differently. So when the crisis hits and we have a reaction, okay, I do too, but what do you do next? How do you make a decision? How do you decide what to do? How to act through that crisis? The reason that we sometimes struggle and we try to use human nature and our human reason. The reason is that using our human reason, our human nature, the reason it's a problem when it comes to our walk with God and our walk of faith is that it's not enough. Using our human reason and our human nature is not enough when we're following Jesus into the unknown. We must acquire some other skills, some other abilities. We must train ourselves and mature so that our actions and behaviors are different. Using human wisdom will cause problems. If you're trying to walk the walk of faith and you're going through life following God into the unknown and you use human reason and human wisdom to handle the crises and the famines and the situations that come up, it's going to cause problems. We see it in Abram's life. Let's continue reading Genesis 12, verse 14. And sure enough, when Abram arrived in Egypt, everyone noticed Sarai's beauty. When the palace officials saw her, they sang her praises. to Pharaoh their king. And Sarai was taken into his palace. And Pharaoh gave Abram many gifts because of her: sheep, goats, cattle, male and female donkeys, male and female servants, and camels. But the Lord sent terrible plagues upon Pharaoh and his household because of Sarai, Abram's wife. So Pharaoh summoned Abram and accused him sharply. "What have you done to me?" he demanded. "Why didn't you tell me she was your wife? Why did you say she is my sister and allow me to take her as my wife? Now then, here is your wife. Take her and get out of here." Pharaoh ordered some of his men to escort them, and he sent Abram out of the country along with his wife and all his possessions. Abram's human reason led him to some significant problems. Part of the problems arose because he was following God into the unknown. He wasn't on his own journey. He was on a journey of faith. God was leading him somewhere, and God had plans for him and his family and his wife. And what he did was not acceptable. It was going to derail God's plan. And so God stepped in and said, "This isn't going to work." So he himself put pressure on Pharaoh and caused Pharaoh to understand what was going on, figure it out, and make an adjustment. He put his wife at risk. She was to become the mother of the Jewish nation, the Jewish race. He brought judgment down on Pharaoh because of his human wisdom, because of his lies. He did not go to God for help with the test. Maybe Abram didn't think to go to God. Again, he is new to this walk of faith. He doesn't know God very well. Maybe he didn't think, "I should go ask God about this. You know, he's the one that sent me on this journey. He's the one I'm following. Maybe I should ask him." He didn't reflect. Lastly, he didn't reflect a faith that would point people to God. And so, unfortunately, Pharaoh sees this guy worshiping a new God, an unknown God. And because of his human reason and wisdom that he used to get through a problem, he didn't point to God as Pharaoh interacted with him. Pharaoh had to realize that he had a God that he was serving that was powerful because of the things that were happening to him, not because of Abram's example. When we use our human reason or nature, we will produce problems for ourselves and others. We will cause others to question our faith, and ultimately, they could question the existence of God. I've certainly known people that wonder if there can be a God, because they don't really see enough authentic faith in the lives of others. We testify to God, though, when we live by faith, when we seek his wisdom and follow it, when we obey what he has commanded us to do, we show others, right? It's an example to others. That's not the only reason to do it. It's also so things go better for us. When we follow God, when we live by faith, when we trust him, we avoid problems and pitfalls in life. But we also show others that God is real. Faith is a muscle, and it must be exercised in order for it to grow. And what I love about the story of Abram is you can see it. You can see the process. And this is how it works. God says, "Hey, come and follow me." And we say, "Okay, I will." And we step out in faith. Then a famine hits, a storm hits, a problem hits. And we revert back to our human nature and reason. We try to solve it, and it doesn't work. We run into trouble. And then we go to God. "God, I need some help here." And he teaches us to walk by faith. Faith for Abram would be learned and hard fought. He would be tested to see if he really would trust God. And there are greater tests ahead in his story than this one. It's a pretty small test, but it was big to him. It was life-threatening. This is, in fact, the only way to determine that your faith is real. Fake faith is of no value to you. It will do nothing for you. The test today, one of the tests today, I was talking about some guys this morning at men's breakfast. We have breakfast once a month. And we're talking about the nature of the world we live in. And there's a test today for young people especially, but for all of us in this walk of faith. You know, our country does have a history of following Jesus, of Christianity. It's been a dominant force, a force in this country. And many people have followed Jesus, have claimed to be Christians over the years. And yet now we see the pressure coming on us from a number of areas. When our young people go to college, They are accosted by professors who try to get them to question their faith, shake them loose from it. The biggest movement that I see is what we call a progressive movement, all right? Progressivism, it's a philosophy, gets involved in politics a little bit, but I think it looks more like a religion in a lot of ways. And that movement says, we're going to give you things, you're going to believe things, you're going to acquire things, and it's going to feel good. So your faith gets connected to feeling good. And if it doesn't feel good, then it's not good for you and it can't be a good thing. And so we have a whole group of people in our culture making decisions about faith really just based on how it feels. How does it feel that the Bible says this or that, right? How does it feel? Do I like that? Do I not like it? Well, that doesn't feel good. It feels yucky. And so that can't be good. And so that is the determination. There's a story told of a pastor named Stephen Belinsky. And he started his confirmation class with a jar of full of beans. And he asked the students to guess how many beans are in the jar. And on a big pad of paper, he writes down their estimates, right, of the class. And then next to these estimates, he helps them make another list. List of their favorite songs. When the lists are complete, he reveals the actual number of beans in the jar. The whole class looks over their guesses to see which estimate is closest to being right. Then Belinsky turns to the list of favorite songs. He asks, which one of these is closest to being right? The students say, that's ridiculous. A song isn't right or wrong. You're not looking for the right answer. Right? A person's favorite song is purely based on it's a matter of taste. And Belinsky asked them if choosing one's faith is more like a favorite song or deciding and determining how many beans are in a jar. And he says most of them say it's more like picking a favorite song, which is pretty troubling. The guy interviewing him said, well, what do you do after that? Do you confirm them if they say that's how they pick their faith? And he said, well, first, I try to argue it out of them. If we base our faith not on a relationship with God, not on our experience of walking with God, not learning and studying and determining what the truth is, if we base it simply on what we feel, then it's not going to stand the test. It's not going to stand the test, because when things don't feel good, we'll walk away from it. We won't live it out, right? And crises and storms don't feel good very often. You will need to learn an important lesson in order to pass the tests you will face in this life of following God into the unknown. You will need to learn to fear God and nothing else. Mark 4, verse 39, our story of the disciples in a storm. Jesus is asleep in the back of the boat. The storm hits. The waves are crashing over the edge. It's filling with water. They wake Jesus up. Teacher, don't you care about us? We're going to drown. The remainder of the story is this. It says Jesus woke up. He rebuked the wind and said to the waves, silence, be still. Suddenly the wind stopped and there was a great calm. Then he asked them, why are you afraid? Do you still have no faith? The disciples were absolutely terrified. Who is this man? They asked each other. Even the wind and the waves obey him. Because the concern of the disciples was a legitimate concern, they had reason to be afraid of the wind and the waves, Jesus stands up and speaks to the storm. His voice, the words that came out of his mouth, had the power to stop the wind. You know that Jesus spoke the universe into being. The power of his words is power enough to handle anything in our world, to stop anything, to make anything happen. And prior to this, this story is interesting, because prior to Jesus doing what he did, they were afraid of the storm. But after he spoke to the wind and waves, it says they were terrified. They were terrified of him. We've got to learn in our lives who to be afraid of, who to fear. And in a life of faith, the only person you fear is the God of the universe, the one who can speak to the wind and the waves and stop them. Do you think he has the power to help you through your problem, to help you find a solution? Do you think you can choose to live by faith? Jesus told his followers the same principle in Matthew 10, verse 28. He said, "Don't be afraid of those who want to kill your body. They cannot touch your soul. Fear only God who can destroy both soul and body in hell." If you think the storm or test or trial that you're in or that you've faced or that you're looking down is scary, then I think you've really not encountered Jesus, the Messiah. He can control anything in this universe by speaking. Fear is real, though. It's huge, and it's a huge motivator, and we will be afraid of things. I'm not making light of this, and I'm not trying to say this is easy. This can be a difficult thing to navigate and figure out. One summer night during a severe thunderstorm, a mother was tucking her small son into bed. She was about to turn off the light when he asked her in a trembling voice, "Mommy, would you stay with me all night?" Smiling, the mother gave him a warm, reassuring hug and said tenderly, "I can't, dear. I have to sleep in Daddy's room." A long silence followed. At last, it was broken by a shaky voice saying, "That big sissy." Hey, fear is real. It's real. There are real storms in life. Not making light of that, and I'm not saying it's easy always to navigate those and to trust God in the midst of them. But guys, folk, we have to understand who it is to be afraid of, who it is that has the power. And the storms we face, even if it's the enemy bringing them on, the storms we see going on in our country, in our world, the storms of famines and plagues and all kinds of things. Guys, listen, the real power, the real one to be afraid of when we make decisions is the God who rules the universe. Maybe you need Jesus to speak into your storm or trial. Maybe you need to read the words he has spoken already about your trial found in his word. Maybe you need to fear a little less the storm you're facing and fear him a little bit more. John Wesley wrote the following letter from his deathbed to William Wilberforce to encourage him in his prolonged fight against slavery in England. He said, unless the divine power has raised you up, I see not how you can go through your glorious enterprise in opposing that abominable practice of slavery, which is the scandal of religion, of England and of human nature. Unless God has raised you up for this very thing, you will be worn out by the opposition of men and devils. But if God be for you, who can be against you? Are all of them together stronger than God? Go on in the name of God, in the power of his might. If God has given you a task, do not be weary in well-doing. We must stay strong in the fight. We must stay strong in our faith, even when storms and trials hit us. This is how our faith grows. Remember, it's the point of them as people of faith. We can pray that God will calm the storm, but I want to encourage you with this truth. Sometimes the Lord calms the storm, and sometimes he lets the storm rage and calms his child. In either case, God is at work in our situation, and we are growing in our faith. And folks, we need to be growing in our faith. Our faith needs to be getting stronger. If we are to face a time of testing, and we have been in a time of testing for a long time in this country as people of faith, our faith must grow to handle the test. We've got to be able to stand in the face of whatever opposition we might face. And that comes as our faith is strengthened. God, thank you for calling us to a life of faith, calling us out to follow you. And Father, thank you for the storms that you give us, the tests that you bring our way, because there's a purpose in it. It's to grow our faith. And I pray that you would help us to remember as we face the storms of life that you are in fact supreme over all. It is by your voice that this universe was created. It is through your voice that the wind and the waves can be stopped and controlled. And so there is no storm or famine or trial that we'll face that you cannot handle. And so, Father, we do call upon your name to give us help in our storms, to stop them, to keep us from dying in the storms we face. And yet, Father, we also know that you promise to walk with us, not always to stop the storm. So give us strength. Help our faith to grow. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Stand with me as we close out this evening.
Some kind of storm sometimes that maybe you don't mean to go or that you don't expect to go through, but I just pray that you will see God as the person who will bring you through no matter what trial you're going through. Have a great weekend.